This is Chemical Processes for Micro and Nano Fabrication. I'm Chris Mack, and this is Lecture 62, the second part of our two-part series on electron beam lithography. One of the most important things to think about, one of the most important limiters to resolution in many e-beam lithography applications, is the scattering of the electrons once they reach the solid. This is also important in terms of the exposure mechanism within the photoresist. How does an electron traveling through a photoresist actually cause chemical change? Well, to understand that, we have to understand something about the electron-material interactions. And the first and most important aspect of the electron-material interactions that we need to think about is called Rutherford scattering. You're probably familiar with the famous Ernst Rutherford scattering experiment, where he took both alpha and beta particles, but in particular the alpha particles, which ionized helium atom, and shot them in a straight line at a thin gold screen, and discovered that while most of the alpha particles went through the screen either with no change in direction or very small change in direction, what we will call forward scattering, a few of those alpha particles bounced straight back off of the gold foil. Rutherford likened that event to shooting a bullet at a piece of tissue paper and watching the bullet bounce back. It was very surprising, and it came to the conclusion that atoms were made up of core nucleus of heavy materials surrounded by a light cloud of electrons. And that gave rise to our modern model of the atom. Well, Rutherford scattering applies to electrons as well as to alpha particles or ions. In fact, you might recall that the first time we saw this phenomenon was during ion implantation. An ion of phosphorus or arsenic or boron was accelerated into a wafer, and we thought about the scattering of that ion as it traveled through the crystal structure. Well, same thing is happening here, although we have an electron, which is a little bit lighter, traveling through this matrix of heavier atoms, the phenomenon are the same. What can happen? Well, most of the time, the electron travels down and comes close to an atom. Now, we call this a screened Coulomb potential because the core nucleus of the atom is positively charged, but it's surrounded by electrons, so from a distance, the electrons don't see the positive charge. It's screened. What they see is the negative charge surrounding the atom, surrounding the nucleus, and so it is repelled, and it travels away in a slightly different direction. That's called forward scattering. Notice that forward scattering is very dependent upon the energy of the electron. It's also dependent upon the exact direction angle that it hits this atom, which is pretty much a random event. But if I had the exact same trajectory of the other electron coming down now at a higher energy, I will still get a forward scattering event, but at a smaller angle of scattering. So as we'll see, the energy of the electron makes a big difference as to the angle of the scattering. But every now and then, the electron will hit almost dead on the atom. And when it does, it will penetrate the cloud of electrons and come close to the nucleus. Of course, the nucleus, being positively charged, will repel the electron. And because that electron is heading straight into the nucleus, it will be scattered almost straight backwards, or at least more than 90 degrees reflection, and we call that event a backscattering event. It's rare, but when it happens, it's a very dramatic change in the direction of the electron. So Rutherford scattering teaches us that high Z materials, high molecular weight, high atomic mass materials, result in greater amounts of backscattering. In fact, the molecular structure has very little impact. Bonds between atoms don't really matter. It's more just where are the nuclei and how many nuclei of which atomic mass are present. High energy electrons result in less forward scattering. Also, a phenomenon we haven't mentioned yet, we can get secondary electron generation. That is, the electron slamming into an atom might have enough energy to ionize that atom, resulting in a second electron bouncing off. In fact, there can be a cascade of secondary electrons. That secondary electron might, in fact, have enough energy to cause other secondary electrons to be formed. Or this incoming electron might scatter a number of times, causing a number of secondary electrons to be generated. And finally, electrons lose energy as it travels through the material. The main energy loss can be approximated as a drag force. That is, these electrons are traveling mostly through a cloud of other electrons, and every one of these scattering events is essentially a drag going on, as well as the travel without significant scattering through the cloud of electrons. And we, Hans Bethe, Nobel Prize winner, derived an equation for this energy loss per unit distance, dE dS. And we use that equation often to describe this energy loss as the electron travels, and eventually it loses enough energy that it stops, and we stop worrying about it. Or it loses so much energy that it can no longer have any significant impact on the chemistry of our photoresist, and that's when we stop caring, when we're worried about e-beam lithography. There's more complications involved in this process, and we can develop fairly sophisticated models of scattering energy loss of electrons through a material. I wouldn't say that we know everything about these interactions, but I think we have a pretty good handle on how they work. One of the things we worry about, for example, another piece of this puzzle, is called the electron mean free path. That is the average distance between scattering events. This is a random quantity, the distance between scattering events, and a stochastic variable, random variable. But there is a mean value, and it's a function of the electron energy and the atomic weight of the materials involved. So we see at high energy electrons, we tend to travel a fair distance between scattering events, right? Whoops, sorry. Here's a 1K electron, and you see it's traveling 1 or 2 nanometers between events. We see there's a range for any electron energy, a range of distances depending on the atomic number. And then finally, when the electron energy gets low, below about 50 eV, we see that the probability of a scattering event goes down. That is, these things start moving around without much scattering. And by the time we get down to a few eV, these electrons essentially become thermalized, just the thermal energy, and they can travel long distances. And in this mode, they recombine with their holes. So they either travel to, say, an electrode that is grounded, or if their secondary electrons have been generated and we generate holes that is positively ionized nuclei, these thermalized electrons then find their positive charges and recombine. But by then, in these low energy regions, the electrons don't have enough energy to cause chemical change in the photoresist. Probably around 5 eV or below, there's no longer any possibility of causing a reaction, depending on the type of photoresist we're using. We combine all of these mechanisms of scattering, and we can put them in a model. Just like we did with ion implantation, we can develop a Monte Carlo model for e-beam lithography. I wrote such a model a couple of decades ago, and here are some results from the Monte Carlo simulator that I developed showing a particular case of interest. This happens to be 400 nanometers of photoresist on top of 100 nanometers of chrome on top of a glass substrate. Can you imagine what we're doing here? Well, you probably guessed, we're making a mask, because this is the kind of film stack that you would have for mask writing. Here I show a 10 keV pencil incident on one point in the resist, right here, of electrons. What happens? Well, first we get forward scattering, so you see this spread about the center. Of course, it's spreading in three dimensions. But there's a radial symmetry. If we were to trace enough electrons, we would find that the system becomes radially symmetric. So here I'm just plotting the radius r, and it's spreading out as it travels down. Once it hits the high Z material, the chrome, we see a lot more backscattering events and higher rate of energy loss, so that a lot of the electrons are being deposited in the chrome layer. And most of these backscattered electrons, which we see to the sides here and here, backscattering event is occurring in the chrome. If some electrons do make it through the chrome and reach the glass substrate, they tend to bounce around until they stop. Here you see the termination of an electron. Terminating means it's reached a low enough energy, we don't care about it anymore. So you see that the film stack has a big impact on the nature of the scattering. Also, let's look at the scale here. We have 10 keV electrons, and we're penetrating a total of about 1 micron or less into this total film stack. And we see the backscattering occurs over a range of about plus or minus 1 micron or less. Now let's take the same film stack and raise the electron energy to 50 keV. 50 keV is quite common for e-beam lithography tools, although we have 10 keV e-beam lithography tools as well. Now look what happens. I've had to change the scale now to go to 20 microns, because instead of penetrating to a maximum depth of about a micron, we see that some of these electrons can penetrate all the way to 20 microns. Very significant difference, 20x. And the backscattering range as well. You might notice we have fewer backscattering events, but when they do backscatter, they travel a lot farther. Right? Backscattered electrons can be almost the full energy of the electron that hits the atom, and so it can keep traveling for a long distance. It's hard to see. We also have less forward scattering occurring here as well. So we get very different results as a function of electron energy. So let's consider the case of resist that's coated on a substrate that has a higher Z than the resist material itself. This is the most common case in e-beam lithography, although there are some special applications where we might coat resist onto a membrane, for example, so that most of the electrons penetrate through the membrane and then disappear. Now, that's a very different situation. But in the case of a resist coated on a material like silicon, it's a higher Z material, or a metal or some other substance like this, then we see some interesting things. First, if we increase the high electron energy, what does that mean? It means deeper penetration into the substrate. It means less energy deposited into the resist per electron. It means less forward scattering, a smaller beam width as it spreads through the resist, and a longer range of backscattering due to the deeper substrate penetration. There's less backscattered electrons that make it into the photoresist, but they travel over a longer range. Now, another consequence of this is that most of the energy being deposited into the substrate, we can get substrate heating, and that can be a significant impact, for example, in mask writing. Well, Monte Carlo simulations are great, but they're slow. They take lots and lots of, you have to do tens of thousands of electrons to get a decent statistics of what your distribution of energy is going to look like. So we often model the distribution using a double Gaussian. The reason we use a double Gaussian is that we have both forward and back scattering kinds of events, and one Gaussian will describe the forward scattering, and the other Gaussian will describe the back scattering. Both of these phenomena are dependent upon the accelerating voltage and the energy of the electrons. So our double Gaussian fit can be used to model or the results of our Monte Carlo distribution, for example. Here's the double Gaussian equation. We see a simple Gaussian here, another Gaussian here, and we've got two values of sigma, forward scattering sigma, and then a back scattering sigma, which I label sigma sub b. And then some fraction of the energy is in the forward scattering. I call that 1 minus beta, and another, the rest of it, beta, fraction of the energy is in the backscattered contribution. Here's some results from a paper from 1979 showing Monte Carlo simulations of PMMA resist on copper, and we plot the log of the energy deposited versus the square of the radial distance. So a Gaussian would look like a straight line in this kind of a plot. And sure enough, I have a region very close to the point of impinging electrons where I get a straight line behavior, and then a region far away from the incident point of electrons that also has a straight line behavior. And these are fit well by two straight lines. That's the forward scattering Gaussian and the back scattering Gaussian. And when I combine them, I get a very reasonable fit of the whole thing. Now, not every situation results in very good double Gaussian fits, but usually it's good enough. And now we can look at the impact of the electron energy, for example, 10 kV versus 50 kV accelerating voltages. Note the big difference in the backscattering range. We go from 0.4 microns at 10 kV for a particular substrate. This is just an example, so it's a particular film stack. 0.4 microns for 10 kV, but 5 or 6 microns for 50 kV. Right? Quite a big difference, more than a factor of 10. But we also did a big difference in the percentage of energy deposited. The coefficient, anyways, about 0.1, 10% of the electrons are forward scattered, are back scattered in the 10 kV case, and a very small percentage, 0.00003 fraction, are back scattered for the case of the 50 kV. So, smaller fraction, but spread over a longer distance for high energy electrons. This gives rise to something called proximity effects. And especially for things like mass making, this can be a very big deal, but other forms of e-beam riding as well. The longer backscatter range means that exposure of one feature can influence the exposure dose seen by a nearby feature. That nearby feature may be half a micron away, or if I have high energy electrons, even tens of microns away, and still be influenced by the exposure of a single feature. What does this mean? Well, if I have an isolated line, note that that line is completely surrounded, a riding line, so an isolated, unexposed region completely surrounded by exposed regions, I get a huge amount of backscattering landing in that one isolated, unexposed region. It's possible for that line then to be completely exposed away. I'm thinking of a positive resist here, but the same phenomenon could be thought in terms of negative resists as well. Also, if I have an isolated space that is a region that I am writing, if I'm talking about a positive resist, I'd write a region, that isolated space might receive less exposure dose than dense spaces. So a lot of spaces close by will contribute dose to each other. So let's picture that case here. Here I show a resist on a substrate, and in the yellow, I have regions where I want to write a feature with a beam of electrons. So if I start exposing this feature with my beam of electrons, I will get some forward scattering down through the resist, but also backscattering, which travels quite a distance away. And some of those backscattered electrons will land and deposit energy in the region where another line is about to be written. A space if it's a positive resist, a line if it's a negative resist. But in terms of deposited energy, I'm depositing energy here. So this line will have its exposure dose influenced by the neighboring line. This proximity effect must be corrected if we want good line width control. The main way of doing this is to simply change the exposure dose of any given line dependent upon the amount of nearby exposed area. And there's different ways of doing this, but mainly we have to calculate how much dose, usually using a double Gaussian fit to the scattering energy deposition, and figure out how much dose is going to be added, and then adjust the dose accordingly so that every line receives the correct dose. Good E-beam lithography generally cannot be done without good proximity effect correction. Let's talk about some E-beam resists. E-beam resist chemistry is very interesting. We're not going to spend any time, except for this one slide, to talk about it, which is a shame, and there's a lot of interesting things going on there. But the first resist we should understand is the most popular resist in certainly in research world, PMMA, polymethyl methacrylate. It's a positive resist. It's generally coded at a particular molecular weight that's reasonably high so that it's insoluble in developer. And then when we expose it, we get chain scission, and the polymer chain breaks up into smaller pieces. If we use a solvent as our developer, the exposed pieces wash away. This results in very high resolution. We printed much less than 10 nanometer features with PMMA, but it is very slow. It takes a lot of exposure dose to cause the reaction, and it also has very poor etch resistance in terms of transferring into the substrate. But it's a process with good process control, so we can get very repeatable results. HSQ, on the other hand, is a negative resist. It has very good resolution as well. It's also slow, but it has good etch resistance. It's silicon dioxide based. So very good etch resistance, but it has poor process control. I think people have told me that it has a lot of moisture sensitivity, and unless you have very good control in your laboratory of what otherwise would be a quite variable thing, the weather, without that good process, good control, you don't get good process control in the HSQ. Might be other things going on as well. I don't think people quite understand everything that causes HSQ to vary in its process. Still, it's quite popular in research applications. And another resist called ZEP, a family of resists that are positive, are very popular for making photomasks. This is probably the most popular photoresist. It replaced another resist called PBS that we used for many years. It has good resolution, not as good as the other two that we've talked about, but it's fast. It has good etch resistance and, as I said, commonly used in mask making. So let's conclude some things over the last two lectures that we've learned about E-beam lithography. E-beam lithography has many advantages. First of all, it is maskless. It is a direct writing scheme. What we write is controlled by a computer. Therefore, it's great for R&D because you can very quickly change the pattern that you're trying to write. It's good for prototyping, and it's good for mask making, where obviously we don't have a master pattern to begin with when we're trying to make the master pattern. It is high resolution. It's easy to get 20 nanometers. People got 20 nanometer resolution 40 years ago. In the 1970s, people were doing 20 nanometer lithography with E-beams. So that is pretty easy. We can get down to 5 nanometers as well, but it's really, really hard, so it takes a lot of effort. Often we have to print on membrane substrates, for example, to limit the backscattering, and then we can use very high energies to limit the forward scattering, and we can't achieve things like 5 nanometer resolution, or even below. It's very flexible, and that's its main advantage in the R&D world. But there are a lot of disadvantages as well. Number one is it is slow. We are not doing parallel processing here, we're doing serial processing. Optical lithography you can think of as being parallel processing. We take an entire mask, a billion patterns that we're trying to print, we print them all at once in parallel. Very fast to do that. Here it's very slow. We're printing feature by feature. We don't talk about wafers per hour in E-beam lithography, we talk about hours per wafer. Typical time to write one photomask, for example, is 24 hours. That is very slow. You're not doing high volume manufacturing at that kind of write speed. The current, which could cause the speed to go up, is limited because we have Coulomb-Coulomb interactions. That's something we don't see with neutral particles, with things like photons. We don't see this kind of interaction, and therefore you can ramp up the intensity in optical lithography in a way you can't ramp up the current in E-beam lithography. too much Coulomb-Coulomb interaction, electrons repel each other, they spread away, and your resolution suffers. It's also hard to projection print a large field. People have tried creating projection printers with masks that project using electrons an image. But these large fields are very hard to come by because of the aberrations that are hard to correct in an electron lens. As a result, we tend to use E-beam lithography where the slow write time does not hurt us. That is, for prototyping, R&D, things that aren't mass, high-volume manufacturing. There has been an effort in the last decade or so, even longer, to develop high-volume manufacturing with E-beams by using multiple beams. So one beam can write a small area. Why not have a bunch of beams all writing a small area in parallel? If you had something like a million beams, you might be able to talk about wafers per hour rather than hours per wafer. People are developing these. There's a program out of the Netherlands called Mapper. Rebel from KLA-Tencor in the United States are both trying to achieve something like a million beams exposing at one time. This is still a development effort. Nobody's actually demonstrated even one wafer per hour, although they hope to in the near future. And maybe some point in time in the future we'll begin to see this happening. So let's look at what we've learned in lecture 62. You should be able to quickly and easily answer all of these questions. How does scattering change with electron energy? What methods do we use to predict the results of electron scattering? What gives rise to E-beam lithography proximity effects? What are the main advantages of E-beam lithography? And finally, what are the main disadvantages of E-beam lithography? Well, with this technology, we've talked about a lithography scheme that is not used in high-volume manufacturing in the semiconductor industry, but it is commonly used in nanofabrication. So in the coming few lectures, we'll begin to talk about some more methods that are used in nanofabrication. Maybe they'll be used someday in semiconductor manufacturing, maybe not, but they're important for other nanofabrication applications. So we'll see a few of those discussed in the lectures to follow. Till then.